this is the first place that I have gotten to see a cliff dwelling here at Mesa Verde. This is not a park where you just drive by and go into turnouts and take a look around. This was a solid mile hike, and pretty much everything here is that, but this was one that was was found in the late 1800s. There's like 27 rooms or something, and they figure it goes back to around the 1200s. So, interestingly enough, about the same era, I think, that we have in Walnut Canyon in Arizona. So, although Walnut Canyon is set up in such a way you can actually walk down into them, I actually do get to walk down into one tomorrow on a ranger-led tour, one called the Longhouse. So, anyway, Mesa Verde is a place I've wanted to go since I saw a TV special about it when I was probably, I don't know, 10 maybe? Long time ago. Yes, they had TV back then. And so I'm really excited to be here and to see it. It's a beautiful park, not particularly crowded at all. I think it's kind of one of the lesser-known parks, but stunning beauty in its own way. There was a fire about, I think, less than 10 years ago, so a lot of burnt-out trees and things around here. Interestingly enough, as you drive up the road, there are these little signs that almost look like real estate signs, very unique to Mesa Verde, that will tell you, you know, that what you're seeing is the result of a fire, and I saw some that went back as far as the 30s, so I just thought that was interesting. So I'm going to go see what else I can find today, and we'll take some more video.
I mentioned we were overlooking the cliff dwelling, some of the fire damage, and so you can totally see that. It would have been interesting to have seen how much more green and tree this might have been if it hadn't been for the fire. But definitely in the High Mesa. I think we're at about 7,000 feet. To get here, actually had to take a road that climbed 9,000 feet and come back down within the park. So this is another one of those parks, kind of like Yellowstone, where getting to the front gate doesn't mean you're anywhere close to anything that you came to see. So anyway, just keep going down this trail and see what else I find. Okay, this is a excavated ruin of a pit house. And you can see here that they would actually build like roofs over them, but they would use the earth's insulation, to keep them warm. This is Colorado, after all. But they believe this goes back to about 650 AD. So, pretty amazing. More ruins here that I believe to have been occupied between 600 and 800 AD. And part of a much larger community here. The sign back there talks about, you know, imagine a life where you, everything comes from the earth, you know. Get water from the spring, you find plants and animals around you, you get clay and make pottery from it. It's a very different life to think of compared to our modern 21st century life, where we get upset if Amazon can't deliver it next day. But very interesting. They call this the doghouse because they found so many dog bones when they were excavating. And the sign here, which I'll take a picture of, just very interesting, talking about, you know, dogs and how they were an integral part of society for the Pueblo dwellers. This one is really cool because it shows two different kinds of building methodologies that you can see sort of the bigger blocks that are used, and then you see some of the smaller rocks that are used. And the bigger blocks were from around 1050, and the smaller rocks probably a couple hundred years later than that. So, just interesting how building methodologies changed as they maybe added on to along the way. This is a kiva, and there's actually tunnels that connect to what's left of that tower over there. And so these kivas would be connected to towers and believed to be used for community ceremonies and various other things, and the towers for lookout, astronomy, all sorts of different things. So again, just really interesting how developed, I guess, the society was with yet, you know, basically living with nothing but the earth. So very cool. So I think I'm at the last of the little dwellings we can see here, but this one called Two Raven House, they believe goes back to 850 to 1150 AD. And it's a little different from sort of the kiva-based ones that I just looked at. Kind of a transition from the pit houses that I first showed and the kivas that I just showed. So this is sort of that in-between sort of architecture. But again, just interesting, talks about they raised turkeys for their eggs. They hunted rabbit and elk, sheep, and you know, they basically lived off the land. And again, just very different from our 21st century life. It's really cool how they built these little structures over these archaeological discoveries they've found to protect them from the weather, also protects us visitors from the weather as well. So, kind of cool.
Yeah. I live at sea level. We'll be in this area for a few minutes, so make yourself at home if you want to sit down, whatever is comfy. Enjoy the pool.
So this is going to be the entrance for this kiva, and then the vent is just right over there. Yeah, so this is a reconstructed kiva. So this is what it would have looked like. It would be on your left-hand side, kind of toward, because the stairs go up this way, and then there's a platform, and then they turn up. As you get to that platform, it's going to be manageable. So there's probably some paths, but...
This would have been the central plaza of this cliff dwelling. There were 21 kivas, and meant 21 little nuclear families probably lived here at its peak. And a lot of these upper rooms for storage. The walls would have all gone up to the top. Really, really fascinating. Those are just some highlights from my Mesa Verde trip. I spent parts of a couple of days going through that. The ranger-led tour of the longhouse was definitely the highlight of the trip. After the longhouse tour, I took a hike down to another cliff dwelling called the Step House, and that was probably the last couple of minutes of video you might have seen. It was another good one, but not as good as the Longhouse. If you have a chance to go there, you need the reservation for the Longhouse tour, and it is well worth it. It is a pretty vigorous hike. It's probably close to a half mile walk just to get to the trailhead. And then it is a 3/4 mile hike, pretty steep downhill decline. And then you have to climb up 2 flights of ladder. And then you have to make up that downhill by coming back uphill on the way back. So it's not something that you would do if a hike of that length is a lot for you. But it was well worth it. They actually split it up. You go down with a ranger. That ranger talks to you about the first part, and there's actually 3 other rangers throughout the course of the tour that tell you about the Longhouse. And it was very, very fascinating. One of the things that fascinated me about it is that the people who lived in that
whole Mesa Verde area, even though that's no longer occupied now, became the Pueblo people of southern Colorado and New Mexico and even parts of Arizona. So it's interesting that, you know, it is still a very important and sacred place for many of the Pueblo people of the Southwest. And they didn't just disappear. You know, there was a drought and they migrated south. And so very interesting. Also, I've mentioned it briefly in one of the other videos. You know, if you're ever in Arizona and want to see something somewhat similar, there is a national monument outside of Flagstaff called Walnut Canyon. They're not as built up most of the time. It's just the ledge itself, and it doesn't show any, there's not a lot of remaining walls. It got, unfortunately, looted very well, or very badly, depending on how you want to look at it, before it became a national monument and got protected. But another fascinating place to go that I have visited a couple times. It's a definite day trip from where I live in Phoenix. So anyway, I hope you've enjoyed this tour of Mesa Verde. It's my next to the last national park on this part of my trip, but I was really glad to have been able to do it. And as always, I hope this inspires you to travel. Thanks a bunch. Bye-bye.